This used to be a village before the water board took over the property. The main street was right up above us here. That has all these huge old maple trees which were here and preserved, and they gave off seedlings. So over the years, this is how these maple trees became what they are today. And as it stands right now, I'm on about 25 acres of their property, and I have about 2,100 taps. And there's tons more growing that I'll be adding every year. What I'm doing is I'm going to check the vacuum system to see what we have for a pull. We're almost to where we need to be. So we are right now at approximately 3 pounds off what I know to be our norm, which is 24 CFM. And that means there are leaks in one of these lines. So Bob's going to walk one line, and eventually I'm going to be walking another one. But I want to make sure that everything on the pumping system is functioning properly first. Bob is walking this line. What he's doing is he's checking all of what we call our loops. What that loop is doing is it's showing if you've got a leak. When you have air in your line, this is what it'll look like. It'll kind of bubble up your sap. So what you need to do is set your tap. And you set the tap by just giving it a good little whack, which seats it. They weren't seated when we originally put them in, because when we put them in, it was very cold. And if you seat the tap then, you have a very good tendency of breaking the bark. Once you've broken the bark, you never get a good tight fit. So I would prefer to do it the way we're doing it now. We got the taps in, now we're going back and we're seating them that it's a little bit warmer, because it's unlikely we're going to break the bark up now. I have 500 taps that are on the opposite side of the reservoir. So if you pan over, you're going to see two black lines coming across the reservoir. And if you look over there, you'll see taps over there. What happens with that is it comes into this little unit right here, which is called a releaser. This fills up to a certain point. The float catches. It pumps it into this line right here, over to that receiving unit that was in the container up front, the same as the other sap coming from the lines. So you've got really two different systems coming into that container for me to transport back to the evaporator. The difference between a one-line system, which is all of the stuff on this side of the reservoir, and a two-line system is that the second line is for vacuum. It's a dry line. And it runs across the water to a booster on the other side. That's giving me an additional capacity for vacuum to get me across the water and into this releaser tank. Sap runs when the temperature starts to warm up. The trees send the sap down at night so that they aren't damaged. Then when it starts to warm up, the limbs are asking for it to provide for budding. So that's how you're getting the sap runs up and down to begin with. So you want warm days, cold nights. So the warmth of the day is what makes the movement for me to get the sap. What you're looking for is the more branches you have, more limbs that are on a tree, the more you're going to get for a sugar count. But do I check that? No. If it's a maple, I tap it. I actually have some box elder. I have a few red maples. I tap any maple that I can get. But the box elder and reds are in here some. But primarily, I've got sugar maples here. When the end of the season is coming, it's very, very clear because the sap starts to turn almost like skim milk. It gets a very white color, and it's very, very hard to process, and it doesn't have the same taste. So that's called budding. So when the trees are budding, it's time to stop. Okay, we're going to go make a couple repairs. Here I have a tap. Squirrels have done a nice job on for me. So I have to replace this. That's a little better. All right, that side's set. Now let's hope this side is set. Yeah. Now we're gonna set a tap. We actually tape the ends of our drill bit so that we're not going in. And after you've done it for a little while, you kind of know where the inch and a quarter is, so you just stay there. Yeah, that's all right. You hear that bump now? It's seated. Okay, here we are. And on to the next one. We have a nice amount in it today. It's maple sap. That's good. The next thing we're going to do is check the sugar count of the sap. This is going to tell me how long I'll be boiling today. This is a sap hydrometer. What this is going to tell me is the sugar content of the sap. What I am reading, 1.1, that's very low. 1.5 or above is what we would like to have. We'll take it. It's all hooked up. What I'm going to be doing now is filling my bulk tank out here outside. I have a little filter that I put on my line going in here to just get some of the stuff off that was in the sap coming from the woods. We take that down each night and we clean it, and we put it back on here for the next morning's runs. Now I'm going to start up this machine. It's going to pull the sap from the container I brought it here from the woods in. When I need it inside, I have goes up into a tank in my attic area that gravity feeds into the evaporator. We are in the process of boiling down sap to make maple syrup. And the way this is done here is it's run through what's called a 3x8 evaporator. There's a steam away attached to it, which is the process you see on the top. What's happening is that the sap is going into the steam away, and when it goes into the steam away, there's pipes in there. Those pipes are very, very hot. There's a blower sending air into the steam away to agitate the water on those pipes. This makes it break away into small bubbles, which turn to steam, and it is then taken out through a stack going through the roof. The rest of it drops down into what's called a flue pan. The flue pan is in the reverse part of the evaporator, and it starts the heating process of the liquid. When it gets to a certain point, the syrup pan, which is this front pan, calls for it. It brings it forward, and it starts to channel through the process to make it into syrup. When it hits the side that you're drawing off from, each day you change sides so that you don't have a niter build up in your syrup pan. Niter is this gritty, sandy part of the syrup that's heavier than the syrup and falls to the bottom of the pan. Every several days we take these apart and we clean all of that out. But in the meantime, we reverse flow each day so that the niter does not build up in the pans. We also have what's called an auto draw off. An auto draw off makes my life a lot easier because it tells me when it's syrup, kicks on the valve and drops it into a bucket. I then check it with a syrup hydrometer to make sure that it is actually syrup. The syrup hydrometer is this little thing right here. The red line at the top is telling you it's syrup, and I don't want to boil it down below, because if I get down too far, it's almost candy. It's no longer just syrup. Once I've drawn it off, I pour it into this container. This container is for filtering. When I get enough in here to filter, I turn on the gas. There's four burners in here. We bring it up to 200 degrees, thermometer right here. When it gets to 200, we have a hose attached from this to this. This is called a filtering press. And the filtering press then processes it through and out the other side, at which point it comes into these 5-gallon containers. It goes into those at 200 degrees. We cap it, it seals, and it's now vacuum sealed closed and has a shelf life of over 100 years. I leave it in those until I get orders, then I put it into whatever bottles the orders are called for and send it out into the market. And that's the process. Now I'm going to be doing my circling of the evaporator. What I'm looking at right now is to make sure that the movement in here is proper, and it does seem to be. I'm not foaming up. I'm looking very good. I'm looking at my temperature, 218 and a half. When it gets to 220, the draw off will start. In the meantime, I'm just gonna check my sight valve here. This tells me how much is in my flue pan. Here to make sure that I'm getting a good concentrate feed. And then I turn around, and most importantly, I look at my feed tank up above with a little sight line. It's coming down pretty soon. That's going to go off. When it does, I'm going to walk over here. I'm going to turn on this switch. I have a pump outside to a bulk tank. It will pump that tank back up, and that's how I keep the concentrate up being fed to the evaporator. One of the most critical things about this is to listen to your evaporator, because it's talking to you all the time. If the noises change, something's wrong. The other thing that's critical is to keep your foaming down. And this is done with a defoamer. And I use the defoamer every 15 minutes. The first place I go is up here. This is the steam away. Open a little door. I look in here to make sure I have the right amount of concentrate in here and that it's not foaming. Then I put my defoamer in. This stuff is specifically a defoamer. Kosher approved. And you do it in drops. Today, 7 drops seems to be the magic number. Now I'm doing the same thing to the flue pan. This is the pan to the rear of the evaporator, which starts the heating process. I try and keep everything in the same place so I can find it. When the boss comes in, it gets moved around.
How's it going, Bill?
Going great.
Good.
How's everything with you?
Very good.
Good, good. Yeah, we're doing pretty well today so far.
Could I do a taste test out of this container?
There goes my profit.
That is delicious.
My temperature is at 219.9. When that hits 220, it's going to automatically kick off. The first little draw I'm going to put into this cup. There we go. Okay. I'm going to test it. And there's your sugar. You're 1 Brix above sugar. I don't have to add anything to it. Constantly clean this to make it absolutely certain I get a perfect read each time, an accurate read each time. Now I take I put it into this container. It's now syrup, it can't go bad. Within a day or two, we will heat this up to 200 degrees and filter it and put it into the 5-gallon containers for storage. What is happening today is we're filtering this off to make it a nice, delicate flavored syrup. If you don't do two things properly, you wind up with an unsavory bottle of liquid. This one, if you can bring it to light, is nice and clear, and it's been filtered out very nicely. The density is at sugar, a little bit above. This one has too much sugar in it, and if you hold it up to the light, it almost looks like it's got sand particles in it. That's nitre. Nitre is various compounds within the syrup that we are attempting to filter out right now in this process. So this needs to go back through the machine, be refiltered, cleaned up, and probably cut a little bit because I suspect the sugar count is too high in this. And that's what this filtering process is all about, to bring you to a grade A material. What Bob and I are going to do this morning is some filtering. The product that you saw us boiling before has been put into this pan. We've just turned on the gas and we're heating this pan up. When this hits 200 degrees, we're going to run it through this filter press, which we're going to set up for you this morning. The way we set this up is each one of these plates comes out of the press and we put filter papers on it. And then we put a back plate in between that and the next one. And we're going to do that with each and every one of these. The syrup comes down through these plates and these holes. It goes in through one and out through the other. We put a filtering agent in between these and it fills up in these plates and these filters. The filter paper sits on both sides of this box. If you notice, the holes are lined up as so. Now we're going to start at the very back end of this and come forward. So all of these are coming out presently to be put back in. So what we're going to be doing is taking these out. Okay, I think I can just pull them forward now. Okay, the very first paper is in here. What I do is I line up these papers with these holes. It's critical I do that. I need just this pipe. Now, if we've lined up all these holes, this is going to work. Now what I do is tighten this down. Okay.
This is the filtering agent.
I put it in, Bob is going to whip it all up into the syrup. That's one. This is the stuff I told you. I showed you the plates in that filtering press. This is what's going to wind up in those plates. And it's going to keep all that nitre and other compounds out of the syrup, giving it that sparkling, polished look. Now, I had the easy job, so I'll take over the stir for a couple of minutes here. And what I'm looking at is the color of the syrup now. If you can see, it's got almost like an orange glow to it. That's the agent mixing all in here. Okay, I'd say we're ready. First thing I do is turn this on. And hope some syrup's gonna come out. Okay, here we come. Don't put it in there yet. Hold on. Bring it down so I can get a... Yeah. Okay. There's your product. Nice and clean, polished off, no grit in it. Looks very nice. Okay, so we're set. So what we're going to be doing now is putting these into 5-gallon containers that will be vacuum sealed, closed. I store those till I get orders, and then I can up in the order form that's required, usually pints. Ready? Yep. 25, I guess. Yeah, this is going to be the last one, but we'll get there. So I was off by 5 gallons. 25 gallons, not 30. See the insides of those plates? See how that's all filled up? That is the filtering agent that we were pouring in and stirring. And that fills up that whole plate inside there because of the filter papers that are stuck between it. And that's the process. Put this back on here. I'm at 180 degrees. I'm going to turn it to low. What I'm doing now is setting the vacuum seal on the container. And what I'm also doing is filling my sample of this lot. That's all in a log, and each one has its own batch number. So when this material is put into cases, that lot number gets onto each case that it comes out of. I know which cases went out with which batch. I'm tipping them upside down so that, one, the vacuum seal hooks up, and two, if there is any bacteria in there, this is at almost 190 degrees, which kills it off. This material is magically coming in and out of there by a foot pedal that's on the floor. I'm running as fast as I can because I'm watching my temperature. When this temperature gets up to 200, I'm going to turn it off, and then I have to race to get it all out of here while it stays at 180 or above. Right now we're at 190, so I have to move pretty fast. I'm at about 219 gallons this year, which is about a third less than last year. I produced not quite 350 last year. This should be probably the last one right here. This is the excitement of canning maple syrup. The jet set out here. This is a good batch. That's it. This is a grade A dark amber. This is a highly automated system of grading here.